Welcome to NASCAST 500, the only NASCAR podcast that wants you to follow Richard on Twitter. I'm Elizabeth Moxley. I'm joined by
Philip Matthew
and Adam Ham.
Hey guys.
Hey, what's up?
Now, normally, since Texas was an abomination, I would let Adam rant about fucktards win. But since we're all about positivity, Adam, tell us about a race you attended after work the other day.
Yeah, well, I work at Irwindale, and it just so happens that that weekend was the opening of the K&N West race at Irwindale, and I figured, hey, why not? I work here, I can get in for free and watch some real racing, and right as I got off work, I kept up with the rest of the bullshit race that was Texas on my phone to see who was leading, and since NASCAR Mobile or RaceView wasn't working, I had to rely on race pages and friends updating and see what was going on. And, of course, like usual, whenever that piece of shit in 48 qualifies up front, he tends to win. And, of course, he led the most laps in one, and I'm glad I missed it because Texas usually puts on a boring show anyway. The November race was no exception. The November race was just as bad as this one. I didn't watch it. I'm glad, but I kept looked up all the issues that went on. Course, he led the most laps, 128. Harvick led the second most, which was 96, and still finished second and should have won, but that's another story. Brad led some laps. Logano led some laps. So did McMurray and Gordon and Candy Cane. And then the other one was Kurt, who led 45 laps. He won the pole, but other than that, it was basically the Jimmy Johnson show as usual. For some reason, Texas has become his number one track now that everyone seems to can't catch him on for some reason. Case in point, the last three fall races at Texas he's won, and I shouldn't say won because he's had it handed to him. Last year, just like 2012, he got the win because of bullshit cautions playing in the hands of how he was able to win. 2012, Brad would have won it had that caution not come out. And same in 2014, Gordon would have won, and then the issues that ensued between him and Brad wouldn't have happened. But I'm glad I didn't watch the race because it probably would have been worse for me seeing him win. Everyone knows I fucking hate Johnson. I hate Hendrick Motorsports as a whole. I just because I like Gordon and support him doesn't mean I support the 48 or anybody else. And then the fucking idiots, of course, the mainstream media always have to talk about how great he is after he wins. Every fucking race he wins, he's somehow championship material as always. But, you know, Harvick's getting talked about because he's an actual contender, and he actually is kicking ass and taking names. But with Johnson, you know, there's just something going on in that 48 team that makes them faster. I don't know what it is. I don't fucking care what it is, but I know that they're cheating, and a lot of the people are just eating it up. Of course, the media, of course, the ball lickers at Fox Sports, they always chime in with how great he is and how awesome he is for the sport, because really, the point is he's not great for the sport. He is exactly what's wrong with NASCAR today, along with Pukemania and all these other idiots that just make him just so bad. I just don't understand how so many people can be happy with this win and just let it go. But Texas was a bore fest anyways. I kind of figured it when he qualified fourth. So I'm like, well, hopefully he doesn't win, and if he doesn't, I'll just DVR it and watch it when I get home. But I kept up with it on my phone. I'm like, okay, as soon as I get home, I'm deleting it off the DVR because I don't want that playing up my DVR. So the Hendrick retards can be happy with this win and think it's all good. And, of course, the lame streamers won't shut the fuck up about him during the Bristol pre-race and qualifying. So I can't wait for that. So hopefully they wreck at Bristol. And they get fucked over because already in the season, they already have two wins within 2 months of each other, and it's just bullshit. Anyway, on to the real race, the K&N Pro race that was at Irwindale on Saturday night, the same race at same as on Texas. Basically, Chris Eggleston led the most laps. He led a total of 102 of the 150 laps in the 99 car. Had a fast car all night long. Ryan Partridge led some laps in the 9. Kind of reminded me of the Jack Roush number 6, just reversed upside down. Dalton Sargeant, who won the pole, led, I think, 4 laps or something like that. David Mayhew led 3, and there wasn't that many lead changes, but at least it actually had some real racing. There was a few cautions for some blow-ups. Someone hitting the wall, the 46 of Hannah Newhouse, who's one of the actual women drivers in NASCAR, on like Pukemania. Eggleston led the most laps. Basically, it was the 99 show. He led the most laps, and I figured he was going to win anyways. But the last few laps, it looked like it was going to... The 61, Brett Thompson, he had a great car, and he kind of looked like one of the underdogs to score the win. But outside of him, it was basically Eggleston all the way. So Eggleston led the most laps. He won. And the second-place driver, Nicole Bihar, how you spell her name, she finished second, and that actually proves that there's, like what Phil said a couple weeks ago during one of the Pukemania rants that we had, that there's women drivers in lower tiers of racing that are better looking than her and better at her at driving, and that just proved to me that that's true. When I watched the driver introductions, I had no idea that a girl was in the 33. I figured it was a guy because the microphone for the driver introductions was all jacked up. So when I got home and read that a girl finished second, and an actually cute girl at that, who actually knows how to drive, finished second, Sargeant third, Grayson Raz finished fourth, Ryan Partridge fifth, Mayhew sixth, Noah Gregson, that's a weird name, seventh, Brett Thompson eighth, Alex Shutt ninth, and then Johnny White 10th, and then Pinhead Larry's kid was in the race and finished 12th in the 16 Napa car. And actually, it was a good-looking car. It's just too bad his dad's one of the dumbest people in NASCAR, but that's besides the point. It was actually a great race, had some great action, and actually, it makes sense that this was a better race, and it just doesn't make any sense to me that with the race that they had on Saturday, that they're considering just flattening Irwindale for another mall, because really, who needs one? So,
Adam, I have a question. If Phil and I come visit you at Irwindale, can we get in for free? Wait, do we have to pay?
Oh, I'll make sure. I'm pretty sure there's ways of that'll happen. Yeah, I don't know when if there's going to be any more NASCAR races at Irwindale this year, but I can see. But it was a great race, though. It was actually worth watching, and it was more compelling than both races at Texas altogether. Dalton Sargeant leads the points, 2 over Chris Eggleston. Mayhew's in third, barely hanging on. He's in the top 3. He looks like a contender. Gregson's 4th in the points, and then the aforementioned Nicole Bihar, who finished 2nd, she's 12th in the points. And I'm gonna get into a little rant about the importance of the female drivers, and not just NASCAR, but other forms of racing. On IndyCar on Sunday, Simona De Silvestro finished 4th in basically a crappy IndyCar, and managed to get home 4th behind James Hinchcliffe, James Jakes, and Elio Castroneves. And she has actual talent, but she's not going to be in the upcoming race at Long Beach. When I saw that, I thought, I wonder where's the Pukemaniac saying that she's the better IndyCar driver. Because, you know, that win at Motegi, that doesn't count, because it really wasn't a win. It was just a back-end kind of win. And of course, she finishes 16th right next to Richard! And, of course, it seems like every time they're on the track, they're right next to each other, so Richard finished 15th, Pukemania 16th, and I just thought, well, nobody's talking about Simona De Silvestro finishing 4th, nobody's talking about this girl Nicole Bihar finishing 2nd. It's, of course, the most publicized bitch, and of course she's going to get the most talked about because of her name and what she's doing in NASCAR. So
I have another question. I'm sorry to interrupt, but Was the K&S broadcast on Fox Fix Sports or no?
No, it's going to be on NBC. They recorded it, but I think it's not. I don't think they recorded it. I mean, they recorded it that night, but I'm pretty sure it's not going to be on NBCSN for a few weeks. But yeah, they televised it, and it's not going to be any of the dickheads on Fox Sports 1. So you want to have to hear the bald eagle and the goat fucker talking and ruining everything. So yeah, that there's a good point there. Yeah, but case in point, the Irwindale race was really great. I'm glad I got to watch it and actually got to enjoy some real racing for once. Fontana was all right, but Irwindale was just a lot better. It's just too bad that it was a lower tier NASCAR race, but hell, it put on more action in 150 laps than the whole season has been in 2015 for Cup. So anyway, fuck Jimmy Johnson, fuck Danica Patrick, and I just really hope that 48 wrecks next week at Bristol.
Yeah, so the first thing with Simona, I mean, she's driving an Andretti Autosport car. So, I mean, Andretti Autosport's the lead Honda team, but she doesn't have sponsorship. And the main reason why she isn't driving this weekend at Long Beach, which Michael Andretti has been funding the car out of his pocket, but this week he can't do it. That's why Simona isn't in there, but she will be at Indy with a sponsor. She's always proven to be a great a representative of women drivers. The rain strat, there's rain the whole weekend there, and it became a timed race, and there was a whole mess with that. I'd rather spend more time on that than the horrible race at Texas, but we are a NASCAR show, so, I mean, Harvick probably should have won that thing. He hit the wall late. He bitched and moaned about Joey Logano blocking him, when at the end of the day, if he thought he was blocking, just turn him and put him in the wall instead of throwing a bitch fit like Tony or Pukamania, and I'm a Tony fan at that. Jeffy had a decent car, but he lost it late in the race, as usual. Candy Cane was there most of the day and then fell back. Keselowski had a solid piece, but not the fastest. Of course, Johnson goes and wins yet another race of Texas. I knew the race was going to suck dick the moment, because I hate Texas Motor Speedway. It's one of the worst tracks on the schedule. Eddie Gossage is one of the biggest douchebags alive. And he thinks he's Humpy Wheeler, but he isn't even the shit that Humpy Wheeler dumps in the toilet. And his track is horrible. They never have good races, and this is yet another example of that. I picked Kurt Busch to win. He led early and then never really got the handling back the rest of the night and finished 14th. So, I mean, that was a bummer for him. Of course, going to Bristol this weekend, it's one of his best racetracks. So, hopefully a bounce-back race for him. And the four team, of course, the 4 and 41, the two Stewart Haas cars that are actually driving properly, both should be up front there. Martin Truex got another top 10 finish, so he just keeps on going with that, and it's good to see. I figure eventually a win's going to come for them. That'll be good for the sport, and No Neck got a top 15. He has to make up all those wins. I mean, even Richard got a 15th place finish out of the day, and after he got about 17 lucky dogs to do it, but he beat his whore in the process. I'll get off of that, and I'll go and look at, you know, the K&N thing, as Adam was lucky enough to go and work and watch. The Eggleston team is Bill McAnally's team, which is basically the Hendrick, you know, Gibbs, Roush, all that of the West Series, because the main the team that used to be there that was dominant, what's his name? I'm forgetting his name now. The champion last year. He won and he retired, and they closed the team. And from last year, he was a veteran. Greg Pursley. Greg Pursley's team. That's the same team that Dylan Kwiatkowski drove for. Well, yeah, Greg Pursley was a driver last year, and he won his second championship and retired. Dylan Kwasniewski drove for that team. I forget the other guy who drove for that team as well. But they were a fast team every single week, and they won a lot of races. But the other team, which the first main guy that came out of Bill McAnally's team was Brendan Gaughan. He won a lot and won West titles for them, and the Napa car. Chris Eggleston's an up-and-comer, but who knows where he's really going to go. Sargent is leading the points, as Adam said. He's a new guy, never had noticed him, but he's probably somebody that's on the up-and-coming deal. And I think that the equipment he's using is the same equipment as Pursley had, the same team or same group. They got the stuff from there. And Behar is somebody to look at, hopefully. She's up-and-comer. Hopefully somebody gives her a chance. The 6 and the 9 team, that's another main team in the West Series. So Partridge is a rookie this year. Both of their guys are rookies this year, but they're a good team, and hopefully they'll pick up the pace later on. Person to look at, two people to look at, actually. Yeah, the 6, yeah, they had two number 6s, I guess. James Bickford, who's the cousin of Jeff Gordon, actually, because his stepfather, Jeff Gordon's stepfather, is Bickford. So he's racing in the West Series. That's somebody to look at as the years go on. And Christopher Bell, who's a Kyle Busch Motorsports development driver and an absolute beast in anything he drives. He won in, I think, 5 different types of cars last year. Now he's trying, and mostly on dirt, with World of Outlaws and USAC midgets and stuff, and now he's trying to make his name driving pavement. So that's somebody to look at as well. He's got a ton of talent. I mean, the West Series will probably be on NBCSN a few weeks from now, and it'll be a good race. And it's good to see some of the new people coming up. Brett Thompson, as Adam mentioned, he's an underdog guy. He's been around for a few years. He's a veteran. Newhouse drives for that team, so another woman that's building up her credibility the right way. So, I mean, glad that Adam was able to go there. That's one of the tracks I want to go to. It's such a great... It really puts on great racing, and it's a difficult track to get set up. That's why Bill McAnally's team has won there 10 times, because if you can get the setup, you're running on rails over there, and everybody else has to catch up.
Okay, there's some sad news report. A man that was driving at the Richard Petty Driving Experience at Walt Disney World. Got in an accident and passed away. He failed to maneuver the sports car through one of the course's curves, and the car's right side struck a guardrail. There's two people died. Wow.
Yeah, he was driving in the passenger seat, I believe. That guy, the one guy.
I actually saw the map of the race course. No wonder why they're closing that down.
It's a hard track to drive. At the end of the day, there was the crash that left Sam Schmidt paralyzed took place there in turn 3. Davy Jones's career ended there. Eliseo Salazar had a huge crash. That place was not very safe. If you had a tire blowout or you had a major off, you were going to hit something really hard. Because there wasn't very far between the track and the wall. It was a challenging track, for sure. But if something went wrong, you had nowhere to go, which is what made it dangerous. And they haven't had competitive racing there in so long. I don't know why they left it open. But it's a sad thoughts and prayers to the families affected by this tragedy. It's a brutal way to see for that deal.
Yeah, I mean, I read the heard about the article throughout various NASCAR pages, and I thought, holy shit! You know, you hear of these fatalities at these types of racetracks, and that put on these driving experience type of things. I think there was one in, I think it was at 2006 at Homestead or something like that, where someone was driving a car and hit the wall and died. Or actually, no, I think it was like, I think it was Daytona last year or something like that. But yeah, I read about it on Facebook and Twitter, and I thought, holy shit, that's something you don't really see every day. The Walt Disney track, you know, that's something that a lot of people don't really talk about anymore. That was one of the tracks that that hosted the old one of the first truck race. Actually, yeah,
the first IRL race was there.
Yeah, exactly. 96. Yeah. Yeah, they hosted IRL, a couple truck races, and I thought, you know, the track was all right, but, you know, it's not a track that was worth keeping on the schedule, which is why they removed it and, you know, paved the way for a lot of other racetracks that have put on better shows. But it sucks to read something like that. You never like to hear of anybody in NASCAR, whether if it's a professional driver or if it's a fan or if it's a pace car driver, losing their life. You know, we've had weird things happen in NASCAR. We've had one of our pace car drivers pass on, and during the weekend at Suzuka, one of the invitational races in 96, yeah. the late Amel Langley, he was one of the first pace car drivers and was the oldest pace car driver. He drove it for 20-something years and had a career himself in Cup. And hard to believe that's already been 19 years. But still, like, thoughts to the family. And like I said, you never want to hear about anything like this, especially if it's by your sport.
All right, Kyle Busch had a press conference today. He talked about the accident that happened at Daytona. He might come back in July. He's not sure. And he might need additional surgery and might cut that in December to remove some screws in his left foot. Don't come back, Kyle Busch. Just don't come back.
Well, with Kyle's going to come back regardless. I mean, you know, it's inevitable regardless of what happens. I think, you know, Kyle announcing that he's going to be back in July, it's a little too far-fetched. I mean, he kind of got the same injury that Stewart got in 2013. So early return to Cup, it's probably not going to happen, at least I think. I mean, July is 3 months away, but still that would mean he would still need to be out of it for at least another month after, because when he broke his leg, they said he'd be out at least 5 to 6 months, and it's only been two. So Kyle's probably not going to be back till August or September. I can't stand the guy. I think he's a fucking prick, but, you know, at the end of the day, you don't really want to hear anybody getting injured, even if it's someone you fucking love. I mean, if Johnson hit the wall and broke his leg, I mean, I wouldn't be... Let's just say that. I would be happy if he broke his leg, because I fucking hate him. Anyway, but with Kyle, you know, it's like you don't really want to see him, you know, as much of an asshole as he is, you know, you don't want to see the guy hurt. You just don't want him to see him race in NASCAR and ruin it like he has already. But I don't think Kyle's going to be back for a while. With an injury like this, he would have to be out for a while, and it's only been 2 months, so Kyle's probably not going to be back till maybe August or September, at least I think.
Yeah, I mean, at the end of the day, for Kyle, the first priority for him and Sam is the birth of their first child. I figure, I mean, while he's doing his recovery, she's going to have the kid, and then they're probably going to want to spend time and get used to the new life. And at that point, if he's progressing, it's one thing. I mean, the main problem is they don't have another driver at this point. They're thinking about possibly putting Eric Jones, or the rumors from Gibbs is he wants to put Eric Jones in a Michael Waltrip car, which is a joke. That it would finally mean they'd have to work together, which the fact they don't is part of the reason why Toyota sucks so much. But the David Reagan front row is thinking that David Reagan will be back with them next month. So somewhere along the line, there's some miscommunication. Either David Reagan's going to keep on driving that 18 car until he comes back, or there's some other driver in the pipeline that we don't know about. It's not going to be Reagan, because he's driving a Chevy, so he can't drive anything but a Chevy. With the awful truck schedule as it is, once May comes around, it'll actually become an actual racing series again. So Crafton won't really be available. So while Kyle Busch wants to come back by July, I don't think it's really realistic. I mean, I don't care how healthy he is. I mean, Tony's never really recovered from that leg injury, and it has nothing. Everyone wants to call him Fat Tony this and that. It has nothing to do with it. It was a compound leg fracture. It's hard to come back from those kind of injuries in any sport. So I don't care how fit Kyle Busch is. I have a hard time believing he's going to make that quick of a recovery and be able to drive a race car, especially under the logic that if he has another crash that could do something that damages his legs to the point where he won't be able to drive anymore, it'll affect his life. I don't know why he'd really do that. I mean, just watch the season and go and look at coming back, you know, by the chase. Take the proper precautions and come back when you're fully healthy. Come back during the chase, win some races, go about business, and be ready for 2016. That's what I would say. But, I mean, Gibbs has a lot of problems going on these days. So, I mean, that's just another one. We'll see when he actually does come back.
Okay, did you guys look at Jamie McMurray's picture that he posted on Twitter?
Yeah, I saw that with the digital display for the dashboard. Yeah, I saw that.
Yeah, I saw that.
Yeah.
That, I gotta say, that's dumb.
Yeah, I mean, it looks a little too futuristic. Not to mention, it's just a little too far-fetched for NASCAR. I mean, NASCAR has always just been a little simpler than other sports. I mean, this is the kind of shit you'd see in F1. I mean, I guess they're trying to move with the times, but really, I mean, it's not. I saw the picture of McMurray's dashboard on a few other Facebook sites and on Twitter as well, and I thought, Jesus Christ, that looks terrible. I guess technology with NASCAR is moving forward, but even then, I guess they just need to stick with the old speedometer that they have now, the tachometer thing that they've had the last few years, and keep it that way. That's the kind that should be in NASCAR. This just looks like it's something out of IndyCar or F1, and that's not, you know, NASCAR isn't IndyCar or F1. It's, you know, it's NASCAR. So kind of 50-50 on it. I mean, it looks cool, but, you know, it's just not the thing I'd see in a cup car.
At the end of the day, it doesn't bother me because we don't really see the dashboards. All we see are those stupid lights blinking because now they have digital. The point is the gauges, the light, they have those LEDs and they have digital type readouts. So what's the next step? It's going and having a digital readout. And, I mean, it's freaking 2015. Having a tachometer and a bunch of gauges. When you spend as much money as they do in cup on these cars, putting in a digital display is the least of their concerns. Personally, do I think it's going to happen? I mean, at the end of the day, this is the same NASCAR where their great chairman wanted to have glass dashboards. So, I mean, I guess this is as close as he's going to get to his glass dashboards, because he's a fucking idiot. But I don't care, it's fine, it is what it is. We're not going to see anything. We're not going to get camera views to see what's on those dashes anyway. So, or they're going to put some cover on it, like they have privacy screens. So the point is, either the driver's not going to be able to see, or we're not going to be able to see it on camera. So it is what it is. If they want to add it, it's not going to add cost. It's not going to affect the smaller teams. Okay. If it's going to affect, you know, smaller teams, which is already bad enough with the lack of cars that show up to cup races that are competitive, and then you talk about the lower series after that, Nationwide or, I mean, Xfinity, barely filling fields, and most of those cars that are at the back are just garbage, and trucks can't even fill, or because they shorten the field, they've actually gotten into some deals where they're running short. But I mean, they have short fields. The costs have gone way up. That's really what I'm thinking about when it comes to that. I mean, if they do it, it's fine. If not, whatever. I mean, who the hell really cares about digital readouts? They need to fix the racing, the product on the racetrack before they talk about interior stuff.
Okay, well, Ray Evernham and Ralph Sheheen are joining NBC Sports, but they're not covering NASCAR. Instead, they're covering the Whelen Modified Tour and the Whelen Southern Modified Tour this season. Good.
I've always liked Ralph Sheheen. I mean, we've talked about the great pit reporters and race announcers that have been forgotten by NASCAR. Ralph Sheheen's one of them. He was on TNT for a while. He was on TNT. He was on a bunch of other. He was on NBC. That was
he was on track. TNN.
Oh, yeah, I forgot he was on TNN and TBS, too. But, yeah, I've always liked Ralph Sheheen. I was one of the people that said he should have been the lead announcer for TNT in 2010, but, of course, that didn't happen. We got the fucking Bald Eagle for four great seasons, and then Wally. So it really wasn't that much of a – that really wasn't worth watching. With Ray Evernham calling a race, I don't really see it. I mean, yeah, he was a great crew chief in the 90s, won championships with Gordon, and then owned his own team for six seasons and then sold it. And then he went to ESPN for a few years, and then fuck, who knows what he's doing now. But with the whole calling the race thing, I don't really see it. He doesn't fit as the kind of guy who would call a race. Calling on the pit box is one thing, but calling an actual race, that's another thing. The Whelen Modified Tour doesn't really get shown much on TV. I mean, they show it on FS1 with sometimes when they go to New Hampshire. Usually it's New Hampshire or Bristol. They never show any other racetracks they go to, but they usually put on a good show. I'm not too sure if Ray Evernham is going to be able to cut it, though, but I'm pretty sure Ralph Sheheen can do a good job because he did a good job in the last two races at TNT for the last two races of 2009 when their schedule ended, and after Bill Weber got canned for his bitching about his hotel room not being exactly what he wanted. And now he's a magician, so that's pretty funny.
Yeah, I mean, Ralph Sheheen has always been one of the best announcers out there in general. He owns... If it weren't for him, we wouldn't have National Speed Sport News. So, in large part, if it weren't for Ralph Sheheen, so I'm grateful for that. He's a great announcer and writer. I interviewed him when I went to Pocono a few years ago. He's an absolutely great guy. True professional. He knows his stuff. Calling the modifieds, I mean, he's the voice of Supercross. He's a motorcycle guy first. He's always has been, but the fact is he's an all-around guy. He called ASA back in the day as well on TNN with Buddy Baker. He's been a pit crew guy. He's done a little bit of everything. So doing this tape-delayed, you know, modified broadcast is going to be just fine. He knows his stuff. Raymond, minus the fact he's a douche and a liar, and tried to troll me on Twitter because I asked him a relevant question to Hendrick Motorsports in there, and the way that people call him out on their cheating. He other than that, the fact that he bangs the female version of Jeff Gordon, and he cheated on his wife to do so, but that's a whole other thing. He has been an announced booth of ESPN previously. He's a solid guy. He knows his stuff. He may be a dick, and he may be a philanderer, but he knows his stuff. He's one of the great crew chiefs in the history of NASCAR. Will, on a tape-delay basis, I'm pretty sure it won't be as hard to do what he has to do as it would be in a live format, but he did it in a live format and was plenty fine. It looks like NBCSN, with their contract, NBCSN is covering a lot of the home track type stuff, the modifieds, K&N East and West, probably some All-American Series races. So it's a good thing for those series to get more coverage because NBCSN really needs content, good content. Because, I mean, people for outside of the small niche that really does watch hockey, at this point, there really is no, they don't really have traction. And most of the other crap they have on there is useless. The racing is their main thing, and they're along with CBS sports network. They're really trying to set themselves up as like the new ESPN, as they were in like the 80s when ESPN showed all kinds of racing. CBS Sports Network and NBC Sports Network are both setting themselves up as the places to go for racing. I mean, even MAV TV in some cases as well. So it's a good thing to hear Ralph Sheheen will be there, and Raymond will do just fine. I mean, he's still a douche out of rhythm.
Okay, one more news story before we go to the O'Reilly's Auto Post 300. And no, it's not Fruitcake calling Denny Hamlin six times apologizing for putting a taco in his car. Guess who got elected second vice president of the NRA for 2 years?
Who?
Richard Childress.
Oh, Christ.
Yeah, so he supports the Second Amendment. Good for him.
That's fine, whatever. The guy shoots all kinds of shit anyway. He's done it for his whole life. It is what it is. When you're I guess, among all the perks you get, you can just go shoot shit. I mean, why doesn't he just go? If he's going to do that, why doesn't he just shoot Sarah Palin and Dick Cheney while he's at it? That'll do this country a service instead of shooting all the damn animals he does. That would be a great use of the Second Amendment.
Ooh, gonna get in big trouble right there, Phil.
I mean, you gotta take it sooner or later.
Yeah, well, at some point we'll see if people really do listen.
Alright, we're going to the O'Reilly Auto Parts 300. I said it was a good race, but I'm shocked that a non-sprint cover won, but the winner is not part of the Xfinity, but whatever. I'm happy, so let's go down the list. Jones, Elizabeth's future baby daddy, Guntard, Smith, Silver Spoons number one, Bubba Wallace, Paperboy, Chase Elliott, Chris Buescher, and Brian Scott.
Yeah, I didn't really watch much of the Xfinity race. I mean, really, who could? I mean, I was at the early part of the race, I was watching Bubba's in-car camera, courtesy of Race Buddy, and then I was supposed to be watching Smith, but Smith's camera wasn't working, so I just tuned into Bubba's, and during the live telecast or whatever on Race Buddy, they had comments and whatnot on the side. Fat Fuck Tucker decided to join the party. I'm like, oh my Christ, and he said, Junior, and I'm like, good Christ, like, Jesus, go back to Robbie Burger King's or something, you fat fuck. The race wasn't that compelling. I didn't really give a fuck about it. Sooner or later, both the cameras for the cars I was watching stopped working, so I stopped watching, and I kept up with the race on NASCAR.com, just with the live leaderboard and all that bullshit. And with 20 to go, I saw Jones was leading, and I figured Brad was gonna win. But within the last 8 laps, I got off of my chair, and I decided, oh shit, Jones is gonna win, or hopefully he wins, so I decided to watch the last 5 laps. But of course, I turned it down to not hear those fucking idiots butcher the NASCAR language. I mean, of course, it's like every race in the Xfinity Series this season, the Cup driver that was in there always was better than those two fucking morons combined, and Gordon didn't do so bad in his first stint as a telecaster, so that was pretty cool. But I'm glad for Jones. He deserves it. He's a great kid. He's a great representative for NASCAR and the new youth that's taking over with Bubba, Ryan Blaney, a couple other guys.
Buescher.
Chris Buescher. Can't forget Chris Buescher. A couple other guys. Brandon Poole. I think Brandon Poole is another guy who didn't really get much credit, and I think he might go somewhere driving that 42 car part-time for H. Scott. Did a good job finishing 13th, finished ahead of a lot of the people, including everybody's favorite rookie, Suarez. I can't fucking stand that fucker. Anyway, glad Jones won. I'm really glad Brad didn't win. I mean, as much as I love Brad, I'm really tired of the Cup guys winning. And besides the opener at Daytona with Reed, it's just been a fucking Cup driver's extravaganza with Harvick winning at Atlanta, Dillon winning in Vegas, and now we finally get an Xfinity, well, not really an Xfinity driver, but truck driver. It's funny that not only he's not an Xfinity, or he's not a Cup regular, but he's not an Xfinity regular either, so that kind of just puts the nail on the coffin. But Jones, he led the most laps. I figured he was going to be one of the drivers to contend with, and he was. He kind of pulled a Chase Elliott this year. beat the Cup drivers and passed it in wins too. So the most wins for a young kid. So he's younger than Chase Elliott, and he's already winning his first Xfinity race. And I figure he's going to be a contender for the title this year in trucks, and maybe run some more Xfinity races this year. And I'm pretty sure he's going to get a few wins down the line.
Yeah, I mean, it sucks. I've been tired and last week, and I fell asleep. And of course, the Xfinity race was better than the Cup race. And Jones winning his first race, I mean, it was a matter of time. It's not if, when with him. A cool car with the Mortal Kombat paint scheme, and he's gonna win more races. If not this year, in general, in Xfinity, I think it's just gonna happen. He is a favorite to win the truck championship, and once they get back started after their 18-month break, like they take after every race seemingly at the start of the season, we'll see what he has. And I mean, the Cup guy's dominating, that's usual, but he led the most laps, more times, started on pole. The irony that he's a truck regular and taking points and stuff off the regulars is just typical of what the series has become. But when you look at the points, there's the top four separated by 15, and 22 points separates the first through sixth. So, I mean, it's a really compelling battle. 2 points between Ty Dillon and Chris Buescher. Chase Elliott, for as much as he's struggled so far this year, I mean, you say he struggled compared to what he did last year when he was pretty darn good. Three top fives and five top tens. That's better than Dillon, but he had the bad Daytona finish. He's only 11 points out, and Bubba Wallace only has two top tens, but he's been uber consistent finishing, hence he's fourth and leading the rookie points. So the battle, while the idiots that cover the series don't really focus on what a good points battle there is and on the regulars, I think that's something to look at later in the year once they finally get away and do some non-companion events. You see some of the regulars you're talking about. 2, 3, 4. Yeah, 5 out of the top 10 were regulars. So, I mean, it's not horrible. It's not great. But it's typical of what NASCAR has done to the series, where they've taken the identity away. The fact that you can get 50% on a 1.5-mile racetrack is pretty good. Brendan Poole, I agree with Adam on that one. Because Young Money's at his illness or dehydration, whatever it is, Poole's gotten an opportunity. Him and the guy that's Harrison Rhodes, he's going to be another guy that I think is going to be someone to reckon with. Young kid. So, I mean, the youth of the sport is there. It's just about getting them opportunities to prove themselves and give themselves a real chance, because there's a great amount of talent coming up. It's just hopefully they get in the right spot.
Okay, we are going to Bristol for the Food City blah 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 support Steve Byrnes and stand up for cancer. Which, but by the way, you know, I'm torn. I mean, it's great that we're all supporting Steve, and we want to stand up to cancer, I think. But, God's sakes, leave the guy alone. He's battling a serious disease, and you don't need to publicize that.
Yeah, I mean, I don't understand the whole name of the race. I mean, like Liz said, I'm with her. It's great that, you know, we're all for Steve Byrnes and that we're renaming the race for Steve Byrnes, but the race name is a little long. Food City 500 in support of Steve Byrnes in Stand Up to Cancer. That's a little long of a race name, but they should just call it the Steve Byrnes 500. But, you know, and Bristol is one of Steve Byrnes' favorite racetracks, so it makes sense.
By the way,
but,
I saw a picture today, on one of the Facebook pages that he had to go back to the hospital because he got pneumonia.
Yeah, that was a couple days ago after, on his birthday, actually, that's what happened.
Huh. Yeah, I mean, I read about that and saw the picture. I thought, Jesus Christ, it's looking really bad. But, you know, Steve's fought great so far. I honestly think that it's a 50-50 shot. He might make it, he might not. I hope he will, but the pictures that I've seen, it doesn't really look good to me. And I said this a few weeks ago on one of our other shows. You know, it sucks that we lose the greats and we get assholes like Adam Alexander and the goat fucker and Vince Welch, but will we lose him and of course a couple other people along the way, Benny Parsons among them, Neil Bonnet, and a couple other guys that were a part of race teams in NASCAR, the television announcers and pit road reporters that have bit the dust, and it just sucks that if we lose him, we're fucked. You know, we don't have that many people left that are that good. You know, you have Marty Schneider. He's decent. I mean, he was great back in the day. Now he's just starting to get a little irrelevant with of course, Jamie Little. She's hot, but she's kind of adult most of the time. Chris Neville, like Phil said a couple weeks ago, he just doesn't really belong in NASCAR covering pits. What needs to go back to sports cars with Matt Yoakum. I still like Yoakum, and I always have, and you know, he's one of the few pit reporters on Fox that I can stand to a point. And with NBC, we have Marty Schneider coming back, Dave Byrnes, Mike Massaro, and Kelly Stavis, who's part of NASCAR America, and that doesn't seem that bad of a lineup. At least they don't have any of the other idiots that are on pit road that just make me want to cringe. But you know, I love Steve's a great guy, and I think he'll keep fighting, and I think it'll end up good for him. But like Liz said, we just kind of don't need to just push it out there. I mean, he's dealing with enough already.
Yeah, I mean, it's nice.
This is pure exploitation of the guy's sickness.
Yeah, I mean, I get the sentiment for Steve Byrnes, but it could have been done in a much more subtle way. They could have done some sort of fundraising, stand up for cancer kind of thing. You know, they could have done a tribute with however many fans actually show up on Sunday for that shit show. You could have actually, Food City could have actually, because nobody gives a crap that it's Food City anywhere but in the Southeast. I don't know where else there's a Food City other than that in those general areas. So he could have named it the Steve Byrnes 500 presented by Food City. It would have been much better than what they ended up doing with it. It's fine by me because he's the only person on Fox, basically, other than Yoakum, that I can tolerate. The rest of them could all just eat it, and I really wouldn't care. In general, it's going to be, I would probably say that, I mean, hopefully they put on a good show for him, because the Bristol races recently have been pretty terrible. When they drilled, they went and grinded the top groove off, they actually made it, so now there is two groove racing, but it's up high like it used to be when the track was paved. So hopefully there's good racing, but it looks like there's going to be rain earlier in the weekend, so it'll be hard for them to actually put rubber down because they take bricks. Badger takes bricks for tires over there, so probably not going to be able to put rubber down. It's probably not going to be the greatest show until probably three quarters of the way through the race on Sunday.
Okay, so let's go to our predictions. All right, I am going to say Harvick's going to take it. My dark horse is either going to be Matt Kenseth or Jamie Gumori.
Well, Bristol tends to be a kind of a different racetrack. It's not one person who usually dominates at Bristol, but usually the Bush brothers are usually up there most of the time. So I'm going to go with my picks. My first pick in the big leagues, I'm going to say Brat, because he finished second there in August to Pizza Face. I think he might have a shot at doing something. My second pick to win is I'm going to go with Kurt, because the race here a year ago. He basically had one of the fastest cars, had a little accident, still finished good. I figure he returns to Bristol Victory Lane. It's been nearly 10 years since he won there, so I think it'll be good for him. My dark horse, I'm going to go out on two limbs. I'm going to pick two because I think this could be a real good opportunity for more than just one upset. My first upset is probably going to be Reagan, because Reagan's been really good in the 18 since filling in for Kyle with the 5th place at Martinsville and the 13th place at Texas. So I think he's due for a win. I'm pretty sure he might get an upset out of there. And then my second is Larson, because Larson really needs a win. He finished shitty at Texas after his first race back from his fainting issue at Martinsville. I figure he gets his first win at Thunder Valley and does... and gets the 42 in victory lane for the first time.
Yeah, I mean, Adam basically took my guys. I was going to pick Brad because he has a history of winning there. That team has a history of winning there over the Penske Racing when Krusty was driving that car. Brad has taken to that track well. He won the truck race last year to complete the trifecta in August. I figure Brad is a favorite. I mean, there's a few basically have been mentioned already. 441, 24, 48, 5. There's so many people that really could win, but I'll go with the white deuce or the blue deuce, but it's a white car these days. I'll take two dark horse selections. I do agree with Young Money, because he likes anywhere where he can run high and run it up there and really run aggressively. And it's not as much of a horsepower deal as much as it is getting drive off. And I think him and Shine will probably have a good setup for that place, hopefully, to possibly win his first career cup race. And hard to believe, it'll be hard to believe, and it'll throw a few people off. But my second dark horse, which is pulling it right out of my ass, is Richard.
Why?
Richard.
Why?
Because Richard is one of his best racetracks is Bristol. In his short career, he's finished second there. He got screwed out of a win there a couple years ago, actually. He's actually ran relatively well there. Daytona, there might be about two other tracks that Richard really does well, and at some point something has to give. Either he has to win, or he's probably gonna be out of a job anyway. And I took a legitimate pick for the main guy. I took a legitimate wild card, which I don't know how much of a wild card it is, because Bristol is one of Larson's best tracks. But that is as wild of a card as you can get. Mullet head for my. My really wild out there pick there.
All right, let's have a moment of silence.
Oh, Richard! Sorry.
Oh, Richard!
You can't have a moment of silence when it comes to him.
Can't believe
Oh, Richard17 on Twitter.
Yes. Yes, he's from Danica's back door.
Yep.
Okay.
No lube.
All right.
God damn it.
All right, we'll go to the Xfinity to drive to stop diabetes. It's going to be another sprint dominated race. So for that, I'm going to choose Harvick. And for the non-sprint cuppers, I'm going to say either the Ryan Reed, who should win this because he poor guy has it, or I'm going to go out on a limb and say Reagan Smith. Because he needs a win, damn it.
Yeah, well, I mean, Elizabeth basically hit the nail on the head. I mean, it's probably going to be another cup-dominated benefit as usual. I mean, half the last couple of years at this spring race has been won by a cup guy, namely Kyle. And the good thing is he's not in this, so maybe an Xfinity driver might actually have a shot to win.
But Hamlin's driving the 54 this week.
Yeah, and Hamlin's not going to do nothing because, you know, Xfinity's never been his strong point, so he probably won't do anything. I'm going to go with my cup guys. I'm probably going to go out on a line. I'm going to say Pizza Face. And my second pick to be a Cup driver to win be Harvick. Because, I mean, it's Harvick. I mean, really, this year has been great for him in Xfinity and Cup, so he'll probably do it again. And with the Xfinities, the Xfinity regulars, I agree with Liz on Regan Smith. Smith does need a win. It's been a really shitty start for not just for Smith, but for two of the full-time JR cars with Smith and Chase. They both had really shitty starts to the season. Smith flipped to Daytona, and Chase has really had a shitty season, plus having to deal with Silver Spoon dickhead number two being an asshole every week, but that's besides the point. My second Xfinity driver, I'm going to go out on a limb, and I'm going to go say it's going to be another first-time winner. I'm going to go say Brennan Poole. Because, I mean, the 42 car qualified well at Texas, finished decent, and, I mean, it just has the looks of a first-time win written all over it. Besides, it could be a weekend for both first-time winners, both for the 42 with Poole and Larson. So I think the 42 could have a legitimate shot because, I mean, really, there's not that many cars in here that could give them a run for their money. Buescher could do it, but Bristol's never been one of his strong points, neither is Brendan Gaughan. And another, oh my God, they even spelled Jeffrey Earnhardt's name wrong. Jesus Christ.
Jason? Oh,
yeah, they
spelled it wrong.
NASCAR Public Relations, which that tells you all you need to know about who they have working there.
High school dropouts.
Yeah, but they make a shitload of money and I'm broke. But for me, in terms of, I'll pick Pizza Face. Adam is on it. I mean, at this point, if you're not picking somebody, whoever's driving the 88 or the 22 or the 33, I mean, you're doing yourself a disservice. One of those three is most likely to win on every week. The 42 is kind of a reach car too because when Larson is there, I'm gonna go with two people. I figure Eric Jones actually. I mean, I'll pick Joey Logano, but I think Eric Jones is going to go back to back this weekend at Bristol. And in terms of the second driver, I'll pick Bubba as the regular, the best chance for a regular to win. The Roush group in the Xfinity series seems to be a lot better than the group in Cup, which, I mean, when you consider how bad they are, it's not very hard to be better than that. Three of the top six drivers, I think, in the points in Xfinity. So, hopefully, I think Bubba can make one happen.
The fourth driver is who's not in the top ten is Sadler.
Yeah, well, that's not shocking because he sucks. But and he sucked for a long time. I mean, if One Main Financial wasn't as Napa was for all those years sponsoring Mikey, it proves once again that it has nothing to do with results. It's more about being good with the sponsors, because then if that was the case, Casey Mears would have lost Geico years ago, but that's a whole other point. But I'll pick Bubba, and it's not just because I'm a fan of his. At some point, I think he's going to break through and win a race, and he's been so consistent so far this year. He just doesn't have the finishes to show for it. At some point, I think he's going to break through, and it might be this weekend.
Okay, questions. Not answering. Okay, this one I'm going to ask. With his first win in Xfinity in the books, would Jones have a few full-time Xfinity ride in 2016? Well, if Joe gives us his groom over, yes.
I say he takes the 20. Or better yet, I think he takes the 18 because I'm pretty sure Suarez will be gone at the end of the year because, really, I mean, yeah, he qualifies well, but he can't fucking race for shit, not to mention I can't even understand one word he's saying, and I'm not trying to go out there, but really, I had to rewind it a few times to understand what he was saying during qualifying for Xfinity Friday night, so hopefully he takes the 18. That's probably his best bet because the 20 will probably just be the Cup drivers going to Xfinity, right, because you see Kenseth a lot in it. Jones is in it because Hamlin was in the 54, and Hamlin is usually in the 20 when he makes his optional Xfinity Series program, so I'm thinking Jones will be in the 18 next year full-time. I mean, he deserves to be.
Okay. Yeah, I figure that Eric Jones, if he wins the truck championship, will get promoted. I mean, they screwed Bubba over for Daniel Suarez, basically, because of money. But the Eric Jones, Kyle's guy, so, I mean, I thought that, but I mean, Bubba was a Reggie White slash Joe Gibbs guy, but they decided that they can't find sponsorship for him, so they let him go. I mean, they're not really finding sponsorship for Eric Jones either, but they're probably going to promote him because they need an actual legitimate full-time contender for the title because they don't have a full-time regular. They just have the 54 running every week with whoever they're having. I mean, honestly, if Kyle wants to do a solid for Eric, you'd let him drive the 54 every week because I think that would be a championship-winning car. Without a problem, but long story short, yes, he's gonna. If he wins a championship, he's going to XFinity next year.
All right, not bad that. Okay, Tim asks, why is every commercial on Fox about Dale Jr.? Because he's the poster boy of NASCAR, and he's the son of Jesus of God.
Not to mention, Fox has been drooling over Junior's dick for years. I mean, it's not. There's no fucking surprise. I mean, it's the same with Johnson and Danica. They can't get their lips off their asses because, you know, they have to talk about him. So it's not really a surprise. And you know, Junior's always had crappy nationwide commercials that would just get on your nerves to no end. I mean, Junior really hasn't had that great of a commercial success in commercials for NASCAR, at least I think. A lot of the commercials he did were just... Yeah, fucking, just fucking stupid.
Yeah, I mean, to me, it's overkill with, I mean, I get Nationwide as a sponsor, but who on earth decided that it was okay to go and have segments, just specific segments, about Dale Jr. in the middle of races? I mean, I'm sorry, I hate to break this to people, but not every person in this, that is a NASCAR fan, likes a fucking guy. I mean, me personally, I've never really cared for the guy, and I find it to be overkill, and it's ridiculous. If the guy actually won a lot of races and he was actually relevant, I would get it. Oh yeah, all his goontards are gonna say, oh, but he won 5 races and he was so good last year. Where the hell did he finish in points? He finished 9th, right? He didn't even make it to the 3rd round because he effed up at the first race or whatever round it was. It's like, who the hell cares? The guy is a freaking butt munch who has never won a championship and never will. He's lived off daddy's name for all these years. If his name was John Smith, he wouldn't have a job. It's the same way as if it was Dan Patrick instead of Danica, she wouldn't have a job. I mean, long story short, he's just a goofy old hillbilly from North Carolina who's living off his daddy's name and really doesn't deserve to be in the sport, but because Rick Hendrick has a hard-on for Dale Earnhardt and wished he had him, he goes and promotes this guy and does everything in his power to make him look like he's halfway decent. He screwed over Chase Elliott in the process, too, because he probably screwed over his own team by taking Greg Ives so he could have him as his crew chief because he's a selfish piece of crap. And then his girlfriend is a dumbass, too, with her, oh, they make fun of him. It's like, seriously, whore. Like, know your role. Just know your role. Nobody gives a crap about you. Most of his fans hate your guts, too. So just shut up, know your role, be quiet, and sit in the back.
Okay, I don't want to ask this question, but I'm going to have to. Did Tucker rob McDonald's in celebration of Fixpacks winning, quote-unquote, on Texas? Yes.
Duh! I mean, the guy can't get enough of cheeseburgers. I mean, he'll sell his own mother down the river if he can get a Happy Meal and some toys on the side. But that fat fuck Tucker, and, you know, I was talking about this earlier on the page about how me and a couple of other of our members on NASCAST Derek Coffey and Kevin LeBombard, I hope I'm saying that right, we basically took to Twitter and just destroyed Tucker. I mean, he woke up the next morning and just all the shit we said was just, oh my God. One of them was, what'd you think of his articles? I'm like, honestly, they're like the fucking worst. And then, you know, basically trashed Johnson and Danica and how much he robs Burger King's and McDonald's for a living. And then as soon as he woke up, he posted a tweet saying, I had a couple people try to troll me this morning. That's why my two favorite buttons are mute and block. I'm like, gee, and no wonder why no one takes you seriously, you fucking fat dickhead. So,
hear a Burger King story I had to deal with today?
Oh, God, what?
Okay, so, like, my local Burger King is busy. So, so my dad and I were waiting for our food. One of the workers was showing off. She tripped and our tray fell on the floor.
Oh my God.
Nice.
Yeah.
That's fantastic. No wonder why Burger King is going under. The fucking people working there can't, just fucking pathetic.
We had to wait another 15 minutes for our dinner.
That's fucking stupid, but yeah. With the question that I asked, Tucker not only robbed the McDonald's, but probably robbed the Burger King right after so he could get some chicken fries on the side.
Ugh.
Fat fuck.
Yeah, I'm just going to leave that alone because I really don't care about useless pieces of shit who can't write and are terrible examples of quote-unquote journalists. Instead of, he says he's a journalist, but at the end of the day, he's a Danica and six-pack fanboy who can't handle the heat and probably should just go and admit he likes it from an animal, wild animal at every turn. Him and his goat have a closer relationship than most people probably want to know about.
All right, who will win in a comprehension contest, Jaws or Junior? Neither.
As much as Junior's Junior, I figure he would probably make more sense than Daryl, because, you know, Daryl just makes up his own words as he goes along. I mean, for fucking Christ, this guy made up the word co-opetitious. That's not a fucking word, you fucking idiot. And, ugh. You know, it's the worst part about Daryl is that not only he makes up words and he knows they're fucking stupid, he keeps making more stupid words that make no sense and then throw sentences together like nothing. So, yeah, although Junior and his, and not really Junior, I mean, Junior, he sounds like a redneck, but, you know, he's not that bad. He's more like Boomhauer from King of the Hill, basically.
Exactly.
He's NASCAR, you know, National Guard Chevrolet, or you know, a good name, you know, or hit more than you can't understand.
That's
a guy.
Pretty good one.
But I made a video once about just putting a couple clips of Junior together with Boomhauer under it, and got some Junior fans pissed. It was pretty funny. But
you know, my favorite line of all time, King of the Hill, is
what?
Are you Chinese or Japanese?
Yeah.
Tell you, I like ocean.
Yeah.
I miss that show.
Where's that from?
A landlocked country, or whatever the hell you said, yeah. It's like, sorry, Chinese or Japanese. Like, that's awesome. That's typical Hank Hill there. But, I mean, the Boomhauer one, I mean, I always thought Sterling Marlin and Boomhauer were separated at birth. Because if you ever listen to Sterling, and then because Steve Byrnes, we talk about Steve Byrnes, the one impression we always knew about from Steve Byrnes was his Sterling Marlin impression. And then I'd hear Sterling Marlin, then I'd see Boomhauer, and I'm like, oh my God, that's Sterling Marlin. It's so good. And it's so sad that, you know, he's had his illness and all, but he's still winning races at Asheville Fairgrounds Speedway. But in terms of who's more comprehensible, I mean, when they turn the key in Junior, because he has to be told how to act and how to speak and all that. When they turn to Key in Junior, yeah, he makes more sense. Daryl Waltrip has never made sense, and he's completely irrelevant. Him and his brother should just seriously be sent to a home and locked in a room and never let out for the rest of time.
Okay, why does the media still refuse to give Truex credit for his stellar 2015 so far? Because his name's not Johnson, Patrick, or Goon, or Earnhardt.
Yeah, I mean, you figure by now it's already, we're already through the first five races of the season already, and they still haven't talked about him as much. I mean, with no power steering at Martinsville, they didn't even mention that. They're like, tricks, whatever. But Danica finished seventh, and you know, we're going back on that little tangent. I still cannot believe that people are still talking about that seventh place finish. It's nobody fucking cares, and by nobody I mean actual race fans, not drooling idiots. It just makes no sense to me that they're not giving Truex credit, because he's done more with that hole-in-the-wall team, that little single-car team out of Denver, than a lot of these single-car teams or these starting parks could ever wish of doing. I mean, the 78, basically when Furniture Row started, they were just a shitty team. Nobody cared about them. They had Kenny Wallace driving the car. They had a couple other people in the car, Joe Nemechek, and then they got Regan Smith in there, and that helped them a lot. Smith got him the first and only win so far. And then they got Kurt, and Kurt got them in the chase for the first time. Now, if you put a great driver in there, like Truex, or if any of these other guys, Truex has never really had a chance to show his stuff. When he was at DEI, he really didn't have much of a chance, because everybody was focusing on Junior leaving, and, you know, with the DEI crumbling the next year in 2008, they really didn't have a shot. And then going to last year with Earnhardt Ganassi, you know, the more focus was on the 42 than the 1, so that's why Truex decided, fuck it, I'm going to Goatfucker's team, and then look where that happened. Ended up losing a sponsor and a job, but landed this team. So I think maybe the 78 will finally get some recognition sooner or later, hopefully, but the media is not covering him because he's quote-unquote not relevant. And like Liz said, because he's not fixed pack, Pukamania, or all these other fucking idiots that they seem to suck the dick out every fucking week.
Yeah, I mean, at the end of the day, the real fans know what Martin is doing and what Martin is going through, especially with Sherry and the battle that he had together, and how it's brought them closer together. It's a story. And hopefully for Sherry, her health continues to be all right. And for Martin, this is the best start he's had in his career in Cup. He used to do this in Xfinity without very much issue when he drove for Chance 2. And I always knew that he had talent. I never knew that he was this solid, he could be this consistent in a Cup car. I mean, he did it before, but in Xfinity. So, I mean, look, at the end of the day, the blame streamers are not going to cover the guy because he doesn't have the name, he doesn't have this, that, and the other thing, but what he is a solid race car driver. And if he happens to have no choice, they'll have to cover him. So, it is what it is, and I'm not going to worry about it because I know that Truex is running well, and as a Jersey guy, he's actually a proper representative for the sport. I'll vote for the 78, and I'll know that the 78 is running well because they deserve. We cover them, and there's few people that do, but we're one of the only groups that actually gives him the kind of credit that he really deserves because he's a good guy.
All right, when will people get the picture that Princess Mikey needs to go? Never.
Never.
I'm sorry. He's going to stay no matter what.
Yeah, he's basically going to stay just as Daryl's going to stay. There's no getting rid of him unless Daryl becomes incredibly senile through the post-race, post-Fox season, and then just loses his fucking shit and then gets put in a fucking mental ward. But that's never going to happen. And, of course, the goat fucker's going to be in NASCAR for a while because he's a figurehead of MWR, and he's never going to stop being a part of NASCAR. He's going to find some way to weasel into it and make himself seem relevant when he really isn't. Fucking douchebag.
Yeah, I mean, he's a piece of trash. I can't stand that. I never liked the guy. He got one of the greatest drivers killed in the process of winning his first race. They handed him a second 500 win. His Talladega wins. I could have won in those DEI cars at the end of the day. And I was in high school, so I know I could have won in those cars. He has no fucking talent. He's just a hack, animal fucker who who's a closeted guy who doesn't want to come out. He wishes he could. Like, he's hiding something. Like, everybody knows you're a fairy, Waltrip. Just give it up. And you're a terrible announcer. And his stupid gridwalk, which they stole from Formula One and Robin Miller and all the, it's not original. And with him doing it, nobody takes it seriously because he's a goofy moron who likes it in the ass. And it's just a... And I don't watch the pre-race for many reasons, but that's one of them, because he's so cheesy and unoriginal, and somebody should really clothesline him. And I would send that guy money, or lady money. If it's like Ronda Rousey goes and breaks his ankle...
Ooh,
breaks
his, that would be that awesome!
Because I love watching Ronda Rousey do anything. She's so hot, and I would watch her, like, make him submit like a little bitch. And that would be a great thing for TV. That'll be a way to get rid of it.
Make her fight Pukemania in an octagon. I would pay big money to see that.
Well, the point is, Pukemania can't run anywhere, and all the guys she sucked off can't get in there to help her either.
Okay, I'm going to answer Nate's three questions. Nate, question number one. Will Phil finally try out for the Sprint Cup for next season?
I need a lot of help for that. I need a lot of money, and I need somebody. I mean, I guess I could drive for the whatever the racers group or whatever that shitty team that Ron Hornaday is stuck with. I could be 6 seconds off the pace. I mean, obviously, if they're allowing him and Alex Kennedy, if they allow Alex Kennedy on the racetrack, we were looking at that at work too. Off of doing an aside. We're looking at how Alex Kennedy and John West Townley both look like they have some sort of malfunction. And I had an idea for something instead of in for a poll for this page and in general. Like, we could do the over-under on how many laps it takes Alex Kennedy to spin out, because good grief, he's so shitty. He spins out every single week. Like, last year it was Alex Bowman. He hit the wall every single week. This year, anytime Alex Kennedy is in a car, he's slow in the way or spinning. So, personally, I want to do a poll to see how many laps it'll take for him to spin and for him to go to the garage after he hits the wall, because he sucks. And I think that's another thing that he mentioned, the Cowboy mentions later on with, John West is the other... one. He looks like he has...
I'm not even going to ask that question. I'm not going
to
do that.
Yes, the answer to that is yes, because if you look at him, it makes sense.
Okay. No, but you're better off as a crew chief for Smoke. That's my
opinion. Yeah, well, the point is, my niece is a better crew chief than freaking Chad Johnston, and she isn't even talking yet.
Aww. Alright, here's my question. Oh, Richard, when will Elizabeth finally apply for a position on the NASCAR rulemaking committee? I like my jobs. I like my Charlie Brown job. I like
sending... you'll get paid more, and you'll be able to make a real difference in a sport that's falling apart.
Well, if I like doing my drawings out of stand for hours.
You can do it there, too, because obviously they're not doing any value.
All right, no, I'm not gonna answer that. I'm definitely not gonna answer that question. Nope. Here's an Adam question.
That's a good one.
Which
that
one?
That one's a good one too.
Oh, but yeah, I'm not gonna. No. Oh, Richard, Adam, would you use your influence to convince NASCAR to focus on those from 35th to 43 place for media attention for at least the next two races, so we know who the hell they actually are? I like to know what's happening in the pits, if their stepchildren are at the race, or... Oh, my God.
Oh, my God.
Are they ever going to have real sponsors and have pit crews have been drug tested lately?
Oh, man, he did it.
Yes, I would try my best to convince these fuckheads at NASCAR to do something and change from 35th to 43rd place for the media attention. Yeah, it's exactly. the media, the thing with the media is that I fucking hate every week is that they always talk about the same drivers, even if they don't do anything. If Johnson fucking finishes like shit, they're gonna cover it. If Danica, well, of course they're gonna cover that fucking whore, regardless of what she does or who she does, just to get her fucking name in the paper. They do that every fucking week. Besides them, they really don't talk about the other ones that much. I mean, you see Logano and Harvick there, but really, all they talk about is Johnson and Kukumanian because, you know, that's what they make their money off of. With the pickers being drunk tested, I don't think so, because I've seen a lot of these news about pit crew members being suspended for substance abuse, and I've heard a lot more this year than last year, so I don't think they have. I guess they're pulling a Jeremy Mayfield, and, you know, I don't understand that. Real sponsors, probably not. They're probably going to be sponsored by some shitty hole-in-the-wall pizza joint from bumfuck nowhere, Iowa. Who knows? And if their stepchildren are at the race, yeah, probably not. They're probably in the custody of their mother or their father because, you know, they obviously divorced them for a reason. So, I mean, it's the media just pisses me off because of the shit they spew every week. And it's always the same fucking idiots who can't really write an article to save their lives. Of course, that fuck Tuck is on that list. So is Jeff Gluck and Bob Pock. Pork ass. I'm actually gonna call him. Fuck. I can't stand Pockers. He's a fucking idiot. Not to mention, you know, he always cries wolf on Kurt Busch, I guess, because of what Kurt said to him a few years ago when in the nationwide race at Dover, saying he was gonna kick his ass because he was asking stupid fucking questions. I'd probably say that too because Pockers is a fucking annoying dipshit. Same with Jenna Fryer. So the media can just go suck a fucking dick. I mean, I can't fucking stand him. Save my life. They're wastes of time, wasted space. You know, they're fucking mouth breathers who just get paid to write the shittiest articles, you know. And meanwhile, Phil and me are just, you know, we don't get the recognition because we can actually write articles. These fuckheads just dream it up in their sleep. They're like, oh, here you go. Or have someone else write it for them and say they wrote it. So,
here's my question. If Lee Spencer's name is real name is Candace, why do they call her Lee?
I have no fucking idea.
I think Candace is her daughter's name, and she just decided to use. She didn't have the wherewithal to make her own. So the fact is, she used her daughter made the Twitter. She goes with that, and her. I mean, at the end of the day, she's whoever media, and her husband is NASCAR. NASCAR wire service reporter. So the two of them can't go and write anything either. But I mean, to go and answer Cowboy's question, I mean, they're never gonna do it. He knows that. I know it. We had a conversation today about how they never talk about J.J. Haley sucking at life. And I mean, for as nice of a guy as J.J. Haley is, he has no business in a cup car. He barely does anything in an Xfinity car to justify being employed in Cup. You know, like some of these other cellar dwellers, like Alex Kennedy, who hits the wall every week, and the way that Brendan Gaughan runs in Cup because the team drives for, because any team that Jay Robinson owns usually sucks dick. I mean, Mike Bliss, he's a cellar dweller. I mean, Castle's in between. Basically, he owns a town. The team has regressed. Michael Annette hits the wall every single week, too. He's a waste of time ride buyer. Benedetto has no business in Cup. Josh Wise, nice guy, terrible team. McDowell, Jesus is with him, but not in terms of his actual ability in a Cup car. He's a road racer. I mean, you talk about some of these furniture movers. I mean, Cole Witt has no personality. That's why he got fired by Junior for Pukemania. I mean, Kennedy looks like he has some sort of malfunction. You could count some of the Roush guys basically as cellar dwellers the way they are. I mean, Sam Hornish is basically a cellar dweller, too. Alex Bowman, nice kid. But, you know, I don't think he's going to have enough time to make it. He hit the wall every single week last year in the BK car. He doesn't hit the wall this year, but he's still irrelevant. I mean, at the end of the day, NASCAR isn't, and especially fixed sports, doesn't cover actual news stories. They just cover the same shitty drivers. They cover the 48, 10, and 88, or they cover Hendrick Motorsports, or they cover certain teams. They don't bother to reach, to go and expand their search, which is both pathetic and useless. But hey, that's fixed sports for you.
All right, with that being said, we're proud members of the Geeks of the Industry Network, geeksofindustry.com/NASCAST500. We're also on Twitter at NASCAST500. We have a YouTube page. God damn it, subscribe to it. 13 members is not enough. So just search for it. We have a Facebook group, facebook.com/groups/NASCAST500. I'm on Twitter at Elizabeth Knox, at Elizabeth Moxley. I am not safe at work, and I love to offend people.
Yeah, well, I'm going to go out with my usual plugs, facebook.com/AdamLosenOnTheRider. I'm also on YouTube, youtube.com/SunnyBernard1988. And, of course, I'm going to go on with what Elizabeth said about our YouTube page. I went a little rant about it on the group page about how we don't get much traffic through NASCAST. We have a few people here and there that comment and post stuff, but realistically, it's barely hitting 40 to 50. We don't get that much. So with the 130 members that we have, and there are only 13 are subscribed, and I, and me and Elizabeth and a couple others are one of them. So subscribe to the YouTube page. Give us some more traffic, because we need it. You know, with the group page and the Geeks of the Industry, and then with Twitter, we're not really getting anywhere. So this would really help us out. I'm on Twitter at the Desert Bandit. I don't go on there much as usual. I did go on there the other day to troll Fat Fuck Tucker and make him block me because he's a little bitch. I also go on there to talk with Phil about the upcoming races and what we think is deemed to talk about, or what I think we think is bullshit. I'm on Instagram at NashBridges94. I don't go on there much anymore. I mean, I don't really have much shit to post. I posted more than 1,000 pictures of stupid shit, so go and follow me there.
Instagram's kind of stupid anyway, so.
Yeah, well, I mean, I just created it a couple years ago just to join the Instagram craze, and then I got crazy with it for a while, but I'm kind of over it now.
Yeah, I agree with the whole, Instagram thing. I'm in between whether I want to get on there or not, but hell, I don't even have enough time to maintain the social media pages I do have. I'm on Facebook, facebook.com/PhilipGMatthew. I'm on Twitter at PhilipGMatthew. I usually do my work from there when it's race weekends, posting stuff about my thoughts on the races and what's going on, and retweeting interesting information. I'll put out three other ones at Save Racing for Save Stock Car Racing. Chuck Ellison, a buddy of ours, all of ours here at NASCAST, and his page, SaveStockCarRacing.com. At the Safer Barrier, it's funny, posts a lot of crazy stuff.
Is he from your neck of the woods too?
Yeah, he's a good buddy of mine, and he's a good guy. But it's also, it's actually a real guy and some bullshit, like some of these other inanimate objects. And Richard said he seems to be an interesting character as well. I think he's worth following.
Yeah, he's following all three of us, and he's also following Chuck.
Yeah, I believe so.
Yeah. He unfollowed me last Saturday, and I got pissed off, and I made him follow me back.
Yeah, it seems to have that power. I don't know if Liz has that kind of power.
Yeah.
I guess he wanted to see those naked pictures.
Stop it. I don't even have Twitter on my phone. Hell, I don't even have Facebook on my phone. I just don't need it. All right. With that being said, for Adam and Phil, I'm Elizabeth. You have a nice day now.
step across that line. No matter where you hide, I'm coming after you. Shake down, break down, take down. Everybody wants into the crowd tonight. Break down, take down, you're busted. Everybody wants into the crowded line. Break down, take down, shake down. You're busted, busted. Shake down, break down, take down. Just about the time you think that it's alright.